what we're going to look at here today is something called recombinant DNA technology. Sometimes it's referred to as genetic engineering. Genetic engineering. Okay? And what that means is that involves taking a gene, okay, a piece of DNA from one living thing, like a jellyfish, let's say, that glows in the dark, and moving it and transplanting it into maybe another totally different kind of organism, like a bacterial cell. Transplanting genes from one kind of living thing into another. That's what genetic engineering is all about. Now, I was reminded of that this morning when I was eating breakfast. All right. I was reminded of that. You know, the bottle of orange juice, on the bottle of orange juice, it said, contains no GMOs. What's that mean? Does anybody know what that means? It was like, contains no GMOs or non-GMOs. Anybody know? What? Genetically modified organisms. Yeah, organisms, remember, are living things. That's what GMO stands for. Genetically modified organism. In other words, what that was telling me on the bottle of orange juice was, this orange juice was not made from squeezed oranges that came from orange trees that were genetically engineered. And I thought, okay, well, that's fine. Okay, I'm not really worried about it, but that's what that meant, okay? So, lots of plants, corn, has been genetically modified. In other words, there are strains of corn, different varieties of corn, that have been developed where plant breeders, genetic engineers, if you want to call them that, have taken certain genes and transplanted them into the corn plants to give them new traits caused by those genes. Like maybe the ability to fight off certain insects or insect-transmitted diseases or something better. I mean, it doesn't make sense if you're going to raise corn. You would kind of like it if insects wouldn't eat your corn plants. Okay? There have been some genes that have been transplanted into some food crops that make those leaves of those food crops so that they don't taste good to the insects that normally attack them and eat them, so they can get a better crop yield. That's just an example. So, actually, most of the corn grown in this country is genetically modified. It's been genetically engineered. It's had certain genes transplanted into it to make it different than the ancestors of those corn plants. Make them disease resistant, make them produce higher crop yields, that kind of thing. Okay? So some people, when they're shopping for groceries, they'll look for products that say no GMOs, because some people don't want to consume food that has been produced from plants that have been genetically modified. Personally, it doesn't bother me a bit. You know why? Because DNA is DNA is DNA. It's all the same stuff. It's all the same stuff. But in the early days of genetic engineering, now I'm talking like early 1980s, they didn't start out putting genes into plants like corn or soybeans or orange trees. They started out putting genes into bacteria. Okay, that's where it started. And I remember one of the very first useful products produced that way was human insulin. Human insulin, very important protein. Raise your hand if you know anybody who has to take insulin because their pancreas, for some reason or another, doesn't make insulin properly or doesn't make enough insulin. Anybody know anybody like that? Okay, so what's the condition called? Diabetes. Okay? You see, you've got this thing called a pancreas, right? How many of you are in anatomy and physiology? Anybody? This is old stuff, right? Pancreas makes this protein called insulin that helps your cells of your body take in sugar so that they can use it for energy. Some people don't, either they don't make insulin properly or they don't make enough of it, and so they have to inject insulin from somewhere else. For years and years, people with diabetes, before the days of genetic engineering, they had to inject insulin that came from the pancreases of cows or pigs. And cows and pigs are closely enough related to us that it works. But they're still not humans. Okay? And so it doesn't work perfectly. Cow or pig insulin doesn't work perfectly, and some people had allergic reactions to it. And so all of a sudden, early 1980s, and Eli Lilly, just 70 miles down the road, which way? Which is south? That way? Eli Lilly, pharmaceutical company, just 70 miles down the road, they were one of the first to start making human insulin. And so, if a person has diabetes and they live around here, more than likely they're going to get their insulin that was manufactured in Indianapolis at Eli Lilly. And it's human insulin. And so today they can inject or have a pump that delivers it automatically. Human insulin, that's kind of handy, right? A lot better than cow or pig insulin. But that human insulin produced at Eli Lilly that got factories down there that do this is actually a protein that's produced by bacteria. Bacteria that work for Eli Lilly. Now they don't get paid, okay? And they don't have a union. But I've toured the facilities down there. It's pretty cool. They have these big, in the laboratories down there, they have these big vats. And they kind of look like above ground swimming pools. You know, you've seen big round above ground swimming pools. Only these big vats are made out of metal. I don't know what kind of metal it is. It's metal. And they have all these gauges and pipes and electronics and computers hooked up to these big vats to control the temperature and the pH inside these big vats and so on. And what they have living in these vats are E. coli bacteria, special strain of E. coli bacteria. So the vats are filled with like soup with all these bacteria living in there. And these E. coli bacteria are producing human insulin. Okay, so now they're bacteria, but they're producing a human protein. You with me? They're making a human protein, insulin. And they have microbiologists, those are people who study bacteria, growing the stuff. And they have genetic engineers who work there. Those are the people who transplant the genes into the bacteria to make them so that they'll make human insulin. And they have computer technicians working there and computer programmers. And then they have chemists who work there, and their job is to take the human insulin out of the bacteria and purify it. And then they have people who work in the assembly line who package the stuff. Oh, and they've got chemical engineers who figure out how to set up the big vats and everything to make sure everything works right and make sure all the chemistry in there is going on just right. Oh, they have marketing people working there. All kinds of people. Administrators, office people. There are even veterinarians that work at Lilly. What? Anybody have any idea why they would have veterinarians working there?
testing?
Yeah. Test certain products on animals first to make sure they're safe, and then all kinds of people from all kinds of backgrounds working there. So, Lilly was one of the first to start producing human insulin that way. Now, what that involved was some genetic engineers in the early days trying to figure out how to take the gene, the piece of human DNA that has instructions in it for how to make that protein, human insulin, how to transplant that gene into bacterial cells and then get it to work in those bacteria so the bacteria would start pumping out human insulin. Okay? That's kind of how it works. Transplanting genes from one living thing into another. Now, nowadays, they do it, they transplant genes into plants, like I just told you, like orange trees that make the oranges, that make the grape juice, not the grape juice, that make the orange juice that I drank this morning with breakfast. So, how do you do this? Okay, let's take something that we already know. Has anybody in here ever had surgery? Okay. Probably nobody in here has ever had a transplant, right? No. I know a guy who had a kidney transplant once. Okay, back to diabetes. He had diabetes, and so over the years, his kidneys were damaged to the point where they weren't doing what they were supposed to do. And so he had to get a kidney transplant. And he did, and it worked. So it was sad for the donor. I guess, I think the donor died in a motorcycle accident on the West Coast. But the donor's kidney then was taken from the donor's body when he died, put on ice, shipped to Indianapolis, and then my friend received a call. They went to Indianapolis. He had the surgery where they transplanted the kidney from the donor into his body. Now, when you do that kind of surgery, what are some tools that you need? What kind of tools would you need? If you wanted to transplant a kidney, take a kidney from one body, put it into another, what kind of tools would you use? Stitches, good. Clamps. How would you get the kidney out of the donor's body?
Scalpel.
So you need some kind of tool to cut with, and you need some kind of tool, you need tools to stitch the new kidney into the recipient's body, right? You need cutting and stitching tools, basically. Now we're going to represent those like this. Need cutting tools and stitching. We'll use scotch tape. Those are the tools you need. If you want to transplant like an organ, a kidney, from one body into another. Now, with genetic engineering, we're not transplanting organs, we're transplanting pieces of DNA, genes. Now, obviously, you can't cut DNA with a scalpel, right? Or with scissors. And you can't take a piece of DNA, a gene, and when you transplant it into another organism, you can't stitch it or tape it into the recipient cell's DNA. You got to use some other kind of tools. Okay, and the tools that we're going to use are enzymes. Enzymes. Special protein molecules. And there are special protein molecules, special enzymes we're going to use that cut DNA. And there are other enzymes that will tape together pieces of DNA from two different living things. Okay? And that's what we're going to be looking at here. So, but before we get into that, I was thinking about genetic engineering as I was driving to work here this morning. And also listening to the Greatest Showman soundtrack. I was thinking about genetic engineering, and I was thinking, you know, it shows up in movies a lot, doesn't it? Genetic engineering shows up in movies a lot. You want to see an example that came to my mind? Check this out. Let's see. This is a trailer for a movie where genetic engineering is kind of at the heart of it. What I want to do is look at the tools. Okay, the cutting tools and the stitching or splicing tools, that's what we're going to look at here. And we need to realize that these enzymes that do the cutting, that genetic engineers use to cut DNA, and the enzymes that they use to stitch or splice together DNA molecules, these enzymes were not made by humans. They were taken from bacterial cells. Bacteria cells make them. So I show you where the cutting enzymes come from. Now, the first word here, restriction enzymes or endonucleases. Why don't you write this down here, you guys? That's the first tool we're going to look at. Write this down. This is the enzyme used to cut DNA. That's what restriction enzymes are. Enzymes used to cut DNA. Now, where did genetic engineers first get a hold of those? Oh, by the way, you can order restriction enzymes. You have to keep them in the freezer. You can order them from biological chemical supply companies. You can order them. They come like in a powdered form. You just add water, but you keep them in the freezer. Little bottles, little vials. But you probably wouldn't want to ever order those. Someday you might, I don't know. And there's hundreds of different kinds of restriction enzymes that you can order depending on what kind of DNA molecules you want to cut and where you want to cut them. Okay? But I'll show you how these enzymes work here in a second. But where did they come from originally? Bacterial cells. Okay. You guys, check this out. This is the surface of a bacterial cell. A bacterium, minding its own business. This thing that looks like a spaceship, it's a special kind of a virus that attacks bacteria. Now, I'm just now getting over, I think, a cold. I think I'm almost over it. Anybody had a cold lately? Colds suck, don't they? Yeah. But what happens there is those cold viruses, they attack the cells lining your respiratory tract. Different viruses like to attack different kinds of cells. Rabies viruses like to attack brain cells. Don't get that. Cold viruses like to attack the cells lining the respiratory tract. HIV, the virus that causes AIDS, likes to attack certain kinds of white blood cells. Different kinds of viruses like to attack different kinds of cells. The virus that causes shingles. Nod your head if you've ever heard of that. Virus that attacks shingles likes to hide out in nerve cells. So different viruses attack different kinds of cells. That's a picture of a special virus that likes to attack bacterial cells. And why does it attack? Okay, what it does is it injects its DNA into the bacterial cell. And then, once the DNA is injected into the bacterial cell, there are instructions in that DNA that brainwash that bacterial cell and turn that bacterial cell into a factory that then starts manufacturing millions of new viruses. And then they blast their way out of the bacterial cell, killing it in the process, and each virus goes and does the same thing to another bacterial cell. And that's how the virus reproduces. think the science fiction movie Alien, kind of what that reminds me of. One virus injects its DNA into this bacterial cell, turns it into a factory that makes millions of new viruses, and then they blast their way out of the bacterial cell, killing it. That's the only way the virus can reproduce. So that's why, Claudia, that cold virus gets into one of your respiratory tract cells, and that's what it does. Turns that cell into a factory that makes new cold viruses, and then they blast their way out of that cell, and then they need to go and do the same thing to other cells in your respiratory tract, and the cold spreads. Eventually, your immune system wipes it out, and then you get better. Now, these bacteria guys, they're not totally helpless. They're not totally helpless. That cell, that bacterial cell that has that virus attacking it, has special enzymes that act like scissors. They're called restriction enzymes. And what they do is they cut up, once the DNA is injected into the bacterial cell, those special enzymes cut that DNA up so it can't do any damage, so that it can't brainwash the bacterial cell. It's a self-defense mechanism, okay? Can I show you kind of how it works? So see, bacterial cells contain these restriction enzymes so they can protect themselves. Okay, let's do it this way. Let's pretend that this is a virus. Basically, it's just a protein capsule with this inside of it. What's this? DNA. This is the virus's DNA. Okay. Inside there. That's about all there is to a virus. A virus is very simple compared to a human. So let's pretend that this is a virus. And let's pretend that this room is a bacterial cell. And this virus is going to attack it. Now, it doesn't look exactly like that picture, but we have to use our imagination, okay? So this room is a bacterial cell. This is a virus that's going to attack the bacterium. And it's out here, outside the cell. Okay, here it comes, and it attaches, and it injects its DNA. Okay, the virus injects its DNA. Here it comes. Okay, so this, now its DNA has invaded this bacterial cell. And what this DNA is going to do is it's going to get inserted into the bacterial cell's DNA. And the instructions in this DNA will brainwash the bacterial cell, turn it into a factory that will manufacture millions of new viruses. And then they're going to blast their way out of this cell, poking holes in the walls here, and kill this cell in the process. That's how it works. See how it works. But if this bacterial cell is with it, it's going to have these restriction enzymes that will immediately cut this virus DNA up into pieces before it has a chance to do its damage. That's what bacterial cells use restriction enzymes for. Okay, guys, nod your head yes if this is new. Is this new stuff? Okay, restriction enzymes, that's where they come from. And back in the 1970s, that's before your time, when I was in college, back in the 1970s, biologists, genetic engineers were figuring out how to isolate these restriction enzymes from bacteria so that they could use them as tools to do genetic engineering. Okay, now, that's what restriction enzymes are. That's where they come from. Oh, this is free of charge right here. This kind of virus that attacks bacteria is called a bacteriophage. Phage means eat. Bacteria means bacteria. Okay? Bacteria eater or killer. That's a bacteria phage. Oh, there's an actual photograph taken through the electron microscope of some real ones attacking. This is an E. coli bacterial cell. And these are bacteriophages on it. See? That bacterium is in trouble. It's got these bacteriophages stuck to it. And they're going to inject their DNA. Okay, so let's look at how restriction enzymes work. That's a good place to start. There are a lot of different kinds of restriction enzymes. Guys, this is my favorite right here. It's called ECHO-R1. ECO space, capital R, capital I, Roman numeral 1. ECHO-R1. Anybody know why it has that name, ECHO-R1? It's the name of a restriction enzyme. Anybody want to take a guess? Anybody want to take a guess as to what kind of bacteria it came from? ECO kind of gives you a hint. Excellent, E. coli. There are a lot of different strains or types of E. coli bacteria. What was the big scare about romaine lettuce not long ago? Anybody eat salad? You guys ever go to the grocery store and buy romaine lettuce? Raise your hand if you ever do that. Somebody else in the family does that? Romaine lettuce, okay, they had to take some of it off the shelves not long ago because it had what on it? Huh? E. coli bacteria, okay, which is, you don't want to eat food uncooked that has E. coli bacteria because certain strains of E. coli bacteria can make you sick, okay? But not all of them. Now, the E. coli bacteria you guys are going to work with in the lab next week is a weakened strain, so it couldn't hurt you. Even if you drank it, don't drink it. It won't hurt you, okay? It's a weakened strain. But ECHO-R1 is a restriction enzyme that was first isolated from E. coli bacteria. That's where the ECO comes from, E. coli. R is for restriction enzyme. Roman numeral 1 means that was the first restriction enzyme isolated from E. coli. So that particular restriction enzyme has been around for a long time. Okay? It's used a lot. Now, if you have a test tube of DNA, you're going to have millions, in fact, maybe even billions of base pairs, right? Okay, nod your head yes if that word sounds familiar from last semester. Justin, base pairs? Okay, imagine you've taken DNA from somebody, and you have it in a little tube, and we're looking at a large view of that person's DNA. Okay, here are the base pairs, GC, AT, and so on. But the DNA extends in that direction for millions of base pairs, and it goes in that direction for millions of base pairs. You with me? And we're just focusing in on this little part of it right here. This is DNA in a test tube. Now, if you've got DNA in a test tube, and you add this particular enzyme to that test tube, ECHO-R1. It's going to go along. Okay, it's a restriction enzyme, so I need to grab the scissors. It's going to go along. It's going to go all through. That enzyme is going to go all through that DNA in that test tube. And every time it encounters this sequence, GAATTC, every time it encounters that particular sequence, it's going to cut the DNA. Snip, snip. And it cuts it just like this. just like that.
That's what Echo R1 will do to DNA if you add it to that DNA that's in a test tube. Now, GAATTC is probably in billions of base pairs. It's going to show up at several different places, can you imagine, throughout the DNA. And every time it encounters that GAATTC, it's going to make a cut like that. Now, I was thinking about this the other day at home when my wife and I were having spaghetti for dinner. Spaghetti and meatballs. Actually, that was just Monday night, come to think of it. Spaghetti and meatballs, and my wife is much more cultured than I am. So, you know how my wife eats spaghetti? Excellent. Knife, or with a fork and a spoon. Yeah, she uses the fork to kind of, you know, you twirl it, the Italian style, and they use the spoon, and that's how you do it. Now, I am less cultured than my wife, I freely admit it. I don't eat spaghetti that way. Now, I don't eat spaghetti like this, you guys. Okay, where, you know, I mean, I have a little more culture than that, but I'm way less cultured than my wife. So the way I eat spaghetti, I know you're going to freak out and think this is terrible. I first put the spaghetti on my plate, and then I take, okay, I know this is going to shock you. I take a knife and fork and cut it up into tiny little pieces, manageable size pieces that are about that long. And then I put the spaghetti sauce and meatballs on top. I know, that's terrible, right? Are you shocked now? Disillusioned? That's how I eat it. But when I was cutting up the spaghetti, it reminded me of restriction enzymes, because that's how they work. If, that bowl of spaghetti is a little bit like, it's a little bit like a test tube with DNA in it, okay? And so the knife and fork is a little bit like the restriction enzymes that you add to that DNA, you with me? Yeah, kind of like that. I think, is there somebody out here in the hall that wasn't seeing me, maybe?
Yeah. No, it was the teachers.
It was Mr. Smith. I was thinking, well, maybe that was his band, but I guess not. Can you tell that car door situation's on the back of my mind? Yeah. All right. So that's what happens. That's how you use restriction enzymes, okay? That makes sense? You want to look at it again? Better look at it again. Okay, there's DNA. If you add Echo R1, this particular restriction enzyme, it will cut the DNA, snip, snip, just like that. Now, there are other kinds of restriction enzymes. Like if we look at the next page, page number 3, there's another restriction enzyme, just an example, it's called HIND3, and it cuts DNA whenever it encounters an AAGCTT sequence. And here's another restriction enzyme, HPA1. It cuts DNA whenever it sees GTTAAC. Got that? Y'all with me? Okay. There's hundreds of different restriction enzymes. And each one cuts at a different place. Now, I'm going to jump down here just a little bit here to number 4. Look carefully at this. Now, the two sides of DNA run in opposite directions. So, we're looking at GAATTC. When the DNA is cut, cuts like this, okay? But look carefully, if you read the top side of the DNA, GAA, and then the bottom, the other strand in the opposite direction, GAA. So read it like this, GAAAAG. What do you notice about that sequence? GAA,
P-A-A-G.
Palindrome?
Excellent, it's a palindrome. It reads the same in both directions. You guys know about palindromes? Words that read the same forwards and backwards, or they could be phrases or sentences that read the same forwards and backwards. Words like toot, poop, how do I say that? Mom, dad, a Toyota. Have you ever heard this one? Able was I ere I saw Elba. Anybody ever heard of that sentence? Able was I ere I saw Elba. You know who said that? Napoleon. Well, he said it in French. You've learned about Napoleon in history? Okay. It was in French. Now, this is the English translation. This is a quote attributed to him when he was banished, sent to the island of Elba. Okay? When he was sent to the island of Elba, supposedly this is what he said. Able was I, ere I saw Elba. And if you read the other directions, it reads the same way. Madam, I'm Adam. Here's my favorite. Go hang a salami. I'm a lasagna hog. It reads the same. It doesn't make any sense. It reads the same in both directions. That's a palindrome. These cut sites, you guys, places where restriction enzymes cut, they're palindromes. It's just kind of an interesting thing to know about. What do you suppose we call a place like GAATTC right there? What do you suppose we call a place in DNA where a restriction enzyme cuts? What do you suppose we call that place?
Restriction site.
Excellent. That's the next word right here, restriction site. Write that down, okay? Y'all writing these definitions down? Restriction site. A place in DNA where a restriction enzyme will cut. It's called a restriction site. Now, when I cut that spaghetti up on my plate Monday night with that knife and fork, I ended up with a bunch of smaller pieces of spaghetti. You know what those are called? They're called littler pieces of spaghetti. All right, yeah. But when you cut DNA up and you get a test tube then with smaller pieces, those are called restriction fragments. Yeah, those are the smaller pieces of DNA that result after you cut it up with a restriction enzyme. We call those restriction fragments. Now let's jump back up to number two. Sticky ends. Okay, this is the language of genetic engineering. It's another term in genetic engineering, sticky ends. If you cut this DNA, let's look at it again, with a restriction enzyme, snip, snip. You see how you have this piece on the end that's made up of unpaired bases? And there's a piece sticking out on the end here, made up of unpaired bases. This piece sticking out, that's called a sticky end. That's what a sticky end is in genetic engineering. It's the unpaired bases sticking out on the end of a cut piece of DNA. That's called a sticky end. Anybody look at this carefully? Anybody want to take a guess as to why we might call this piece sticking out here? Why we might call that a sticky end? Any guesses? Okay. Why would we call that a sticky end, do you suppose? You know why it's called a sticky end? Because it's sticky. It's sticky. If you brought these two cut ends close together, they would tend to be attracted to each other. Kind of sticky. Like, you see, if you brought these close together, this T would be attracted,
there'd be a force of attraction between this T and this A, and this T and this A, and this A and this T, and this A and this T. They would be attracted to each other, kind of like opposite ends of a magnet. They're attracted to each other. So they tend to be kind of sticky in that way. We call those sticky ends. That kind of makes sense? Gordon. They're called sticky ends. Now there's another tool we're going to look at. It's called ligase. That's the next word right there. Ligase. That's the enzyme that works like scotch tape or stitches. It's called ligase. Ligase. Very important tool, ligase. Oh, there it is. See, there's a picture of it. That's ligase right there. Now, watch what happens if you've got these two cut pieces of DNA in a little test tube in the lab. You've got these two cut pieces of DNA. If you let them come close to each other, the sticky end here and the sticky end here, they're going to be attracted to each other. And then if you add ligase enzyme, ligase will sew up, tape up, firm up those pieces, glue them back together. Watch, like this. It glues them back together. That's what ligase does. So that's the other tool. So now you got the basic tools that you need, you see, to transplant a gene from one kind of living thing into another living thing, like a bacterial cell. Those are the basic tools, cutting and pasting. All right, now there's some other tools we need to use. So look at number 7 down here. Plasmid. Write this down. Well, first I'm going to draw a picture. Okay. I'll show you what a plasmid is. Here's a bacterial cell. And some bacteria, okay, well, I'm going to add something else here. Watch this. This is all the DNA of this bacterial cell. Bacteria have one strand of DNA. I've got this memorized, see how to draw this. They have one strand of DNA, one chromosome, and the two ends are stuck together like this, see? Boom. So it's like this big loop of DNA, and bacteria are kind of simple. They don't have their DNA nicely packaged up inside of an organized nucleus. Instead, their DNA just floats around in the cytoplasm here, okay? That's the DNA of this bacterial cell. But some bacteria will also contain little extra rings of DNA. They look like this. Here's one, okay? There, see that? Here's another one. And they're floating around in the cytoplasm also. Little rings or lariats of DNA. And they're just floating around in the cytoplasm. Those are extra. Some bacterial cells have more than others. That's a plasmid. Okay, so a plasmid is a little tiny ring of DNA found floating in the cytoplasm of some bacterial cells. They're called plasmids. And that's another useful tool that we're going to look at in genetic engineering. Now, this picture right here, you guys, this is a photograph taken through an electron microscope of a plasmid. It looks like, over Christmas vacation, my wife and I made Christmas cookies, you know, the kind you cut out and decorate. Nod your head yes if you know what I'm talking about. We call them in our family ugly cookies, because when you get tired, if you're doing that for a long time, you get tired, then you just slap the frosting on and you don't care what they look like. But we have this
cookie cutter. It's shaped like a Santa Claus, and it's kind of bent a little bit. So it kind of looks like this.
Here's his boot down here. Here's his sack on his back. You had to be there. Okay, this is a plasmid, a ring of DNA found in the cytoplasm of bacterial cells. Okay, here's another way to look at it. Okay, let's pretend that, okay, watch this. Let's pretend that this is a plasmid, okay? That's what I'm talking about. This is a plasmid. A little extra ring of DNA, and some bacterial cells have those. Now, what's kind of interesting is, in the early days of genetic engineering, genetic engineers figured this out. You can take a restriction enzyme and cut open a plasmid. Okay, so that picture right there, that's taken through the electron microscope. That's a plasmid that's been cut open with a restriction enzyme. Snip. Okay. The plasmid was isolated from some bacterium. It's in a test tube. They added a restriction enzyme to cut it open. And there's something else about plasmids that we need to know. Bacterial cells know how to take in plasmids from the outside, how to take them in through their cell walls. In fact, for years before genetic engineering, before the 1970s, early 1980s, for years biologists knew that sometimes bacterial cells will snuggle up next to each other. They snuggle. And swap plasmids back and forth through their cell walls. They'll make like a little, they'll snuggle up next to each other, make a little connection, or an opening will form in the cell wall of this bacterial cell, an opening will form in the cell wall of this one, or a little connection will form, and they'll swap plasmids back and forth. Now, there aren't male bacteria and female bacteria. They're just its. But they will snuggle together, swap plasmids back and forth, exchange plasmids, and then crawl away from each other with smiles on their faces. No, they don't really smile. I made that up. But that is a simple form, kind of the precursor, the ancestor of sexual reproduction. Sexual reproduction just involves making new combinations of genes, right? My DNA is not exactly like my mom's, and it's not exactly like my dad's. But my DNA is 50% my mom's DNA and 50% my dad's DNA, right? So when they made me, and you know how it works, when my parents made me, I then contained a new combination of DNA, a new combination of genes. Half the genes came from mom, half the genes came from dad. That's what happens in sexual reproduction. You create individuals with new combinations of genes. If you have got two bacterial cells, guys, and they snuggle next to each other, and they swap plasmids back and forth, and then they crawl away from each other, they each contain new combinations of DNA that they didn't have before. That is a kind of a simple, sort of a form of sexual reproduction. Make sense? All right, so genetic engineers in the early days, they looked at this and they said, if bacteria are kind of used to taking in plasmids from outside, taking in new plasmids, if they're kind of used to that, if they kind of know how to do that already, maybe we could use plasmids as a tool to carry or transfer genes into the bacteria, and that's what the plasmids are used for. Here's how it works. Okay, here's how it works.
Let's say you're a genetic engineer working for Eli Lilly and it's 1980. Okay? That's when they first started doing this, approximately. You take a plasmid like this. Watch carefully. You take a restriction enzyme and you cut it open. And then you take a human insulin gene and you splice it here and here. You splice it in here. Let's draw a picture of it. You take a human insulin gene and you splice it in. So here's the, let's enlarge it a little bit. Here's the plasmid that's been cut open with the restriction enzyme. And I'll use purple to represent the human insulin gene. There it is. You splice it in there. And you use ligase to sew it up there, and you use ligase enzyme to sew it up right there. Now you've got a plasmid from a bacterial cell that's got a human insulin gene, piece of DNA from a human cell that says make human insulin. It's spliced in there. Does that make sense? You know what you call this new DNA molecule that's made up of the DNA from two different living things combined together? You know what you call that? Anybody want to take a guess? Maria, what's it called? Good. Recombinant DNA. Because what we're doing here is we've combined together DNA from two different living things that have been separated from each other by hundreds of millions of years of evolution. We've recombined them. I mean, if you think about it, there's a huge difference between a bacterial cell and a human, right? You can't get much different in comparing living things between those two. We've taken DNA from two different, vastly different living things and combined them together. So this new molecule is called recombinant DNA. And sometimes this genetic engineering business, you see, is called recombinant DNA technology. Okay. So let's pretend in that picture right there, okay, this is taken through the electron microscope. This is an E. coli bacterium. This is a recombinant DNA molecule. This is a plasmid right here that's had a human insulin gene spliced into it. And so the next step is to convince this bacterial cell to absorb that plasmid. And that's how you get the human insulin gene into the bacterial cell. Make sense? Okay. Now, if you can convince this bacterium to absorb that plasmid, if the bacterial cell absorbs that plasmid, that process is called transformation. So go ahead and write this down here. Transformation. When the bacterial cell absorbs the new plasmid, that's called transformation, because in that process, you see, the bacterium is transformed, it's changed, it's different. If you can get that plasmid that has that human insulin gene spliced into it, if you can get it to go into that bacterial cell, then that bacterium, you see, contains a human gene, something it didn't have before. So, see how the plasmids are important? Okay. That's how it works. Now, let's see what's on page 4. Oh, page 4 is just kind of a diagram that shows the process. So, all the stuff I've just talked about, this is the picture form of that discussion, okay? Now, when you guys play this board game on Friday, you're gonna, by playing the game, you're gonna walk through these steps, okay? What do you think you're gonna use in the game to represent restriction enzymes? scissors. Where are my scissors?
Right here.
What do you think you're going to use in the game to represent ligase enzymes?
Tape.
Right, scotch tape. So we're going to work with paper models as we play the game on Friday. So that then when we do the actual lab next week, it kind of makes sense what we're doing. Okay? All right, so I talked about insulin, but there are some other useful proteins that have been produced by this same sort of technique. And so let's list some examples here, okay? Oh, that's a highly technical illustration of a bacterial cell absorbing plasmids in a genetic engineering lab. That's what that is. Okay. See, here's the bacterial cell. See the plasmids entering the bacterium? Kind of how it works. Actually, I said you have to convince the bacteria to absorb the plasmids. The way you convince them is you don't get down close to the test tube, you know, and say, please, please, please. You don't do it that way. The way you convince them is you have to dump them into salt water. And that's what you guys will do next week. You dump them into salt water, and it makes the bacteria porous. See how these holes have opened up in the bacteria? And that kills most of the bacteria. That's harsh. But if you only had like 1% of those bacteria survive that process, that's all you need. Because these bacterial cells reproduce, they double, they split in half every 20 minutes. So if you have like one bacterial cell at 8 o'clock in the morning, by 3:30 in the afternoon, you're going to have billions because they reproduce exponentially. So if only 1% of your bacteria next week survive that harsh process right there of making holes in their cell walls so the plasmids can go in, that's all you need because they reproduce then like crazy. The survivors are going to reproduce like crazy. Okay, let's look at some useful products. Okay, we already talked about this one. So write this down, insulin, that's one. And this is a picture of a package that human insulin comes in. And you can see Eli Lilly's little logo down here, manufactured by Eli Lilly. Actually manufactured by the bacteria in those big vats of soup down at the labs in Eli Lilly. Those bacteria that have been genetically engineered that are pumping out this protein, human insulin. Okay, and it says here, oh, and I don't think you can see it on this picture. It's called Humulin. The brand name is Humulin, human insulin. But in fine print here, in parentheses, it says lowercase r, DNA origin. Lowercase r, DNA, that stands for recombinant DNA. So that just means recombinant DNA origin. And probably everybody who buys this stuff knows what that means, right? Probably not. They're just telling you that this is human insulin. It's been produced by recombinant DNA technology. It's been made by bacteria. Okay? So that's one useful product. Now, here's another one. Well, actually, you really can't see it very well. This little boy right here is injecting himself with a protein that will make his blood clot. Because he has hemophilia, bleeder's disease, blood doesn't clot. Since his blood doesn't clot, he could bleed to death from a scratch. Has to lead a fairly sheltered life. And so what he does is he injects himself periodically on a regular schedule with a special protein. It's called factor 8. Okay, let's list the insulin first here. Okay, here's the second one. Factor Roman numeral 8. Factor 8, which is an important blood clotting protein. Okay, that's the protein that people with hemophilia can't make properly because their factor 8 gene is mutated. And so they have hemophilia. So he injects himself with factor 8 that's produced by recombinant DNA technology. That's just another example. Oh, and here's a third example. I'm going to list it as HGH. That's another useful protein produced by recombinant DNA technology. Same way that insulin's produced, only they took the gene that makes this protein, they took the gene that makes that protein and put it into bacteria to get bacteria to produce that protein. Eli Lilly produces this protein also. Anybody know what HGH is? Human growth hormone. Human growth hormone. You know, sometimes there are little kids that they don't grow like they're supposed to. They're abnormally small for their age. They just don't grow because their body doesn't make human growth hormone properly. Like the little guy on the right-hand side in this picture, he has human growth hormone deficiency. Okay. This is his younger brother right here. These two guys are brothers. This is the older one. This is the younger one. This kid has growth hormone deficiency. He's destined to be, you could say dwarf or midget, okay? Because his body doesn't make growth hormone properly. Well, kids like this don't have to suffer that fate anymore. Now they can be on prescription injections of human growth hormone so that they can grow normally. And the reason kids like that can get prescription injections of this stuff now is because the supply of it has gone up. Since the early 1980s, the supply has gone up. Why has the supply gone up? Who can tell me? Why has the supply increased dramatically since 1980? That's what this talk's all about, yeah. They keep making it, they can make large amounts of it through recombinant DNA technology. Pharmaceutical companies like Lilly, they've got these big vats now of bacteria pumping out human growth hormone. And since the supply, okay, anybody in here taking economics? Is that what you take when you're a senior? Okay, economics. Since the supply of human growth hormone has increased dramatically, what's happened to the price of it? The price has decreased. So it's affordable. So now little kids like that are born with growth hormone deficiency, they don't have to end up being little as adults. They can get prescriptions of this, and thanks to genetic engineering. Okay, so that's where we're going to stop for today. That's all the stuff we need to know to do the game on Friday. But what I want to do is give you the lab handout for the game, because there are a few things that you need to do with this lab handout before you come to class on Friday, okay? One, two, those. What? Okay. There are a few things that we need to do in this lab handout before Friday. This is your only homework before Friday, okay? And let me show you here. Let's see. Okay. Take a look at page 6. page section look like this. Okay. On page six, you've got this picture of a bacterial cell, and that's called the host. In other words, that's the bacterial cell that you're going to take a human gene and put it into it. Actually, you're going to put a plasmid into this while you're playing the game on Friday. So what I need for you to do before Friday, come to class with this thing cut out. Go ahead and cut that bacterial cell out and then bring it with you to class on Friday. You'll be using that as you're playing the game. Okay? So you need to just, you know, snip, 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 cut out that bacterium. See, here's its DNA floating around in here. All right? And then on page seven, what we have here is, this is a piece of human DNA. Human DNA. That's human DNA that contains the desired gene, the gene that we're going to put into the bacterial cell. So I need for you, before Friday, to come in with this strip of DNA cut out. Just cut it out. You're going to come in with that bacterial cell and with this long strip of DNA. And right in here, okay, this is the desired human gene. Let's pretend that this piece of DNA from here to here, that's an important gene that we want to put into the bacterial cell. Okay, so I think it'd probably be, you ought to do this. It doesn't say this in the instructions, I don't think. I should remember it, right? You want to color that piece of DNA, that gene, a different color than the rest of the white paper, okay? Make it a different color. Now, so you're going to cut out this strip of DNA, human DNA, bring it to class with you on Friday, but don't cut along those dotted lines, okay? You'll be doing that while you're playing the game. Because when the restriction enzyme encounters this DNA, it will cut along those dotted lines, but don't cut along the dotted lines before you start playing the game. All right, then the other thing you want to cut out before Friday is on page number 8. This is the donor bacterial cell that's going to sacrifice its little body to science, because you're going to remove this plasmid from this bacterial cell and you're going to use it. So, before Friday, cut out that little ring of DNA, that little donut right there. Cut out that ring of DNA and bring it with you also. Now that, you've killed this bacterial cell in the process, but that's what you have to do. All we wanted from this thing was its plasmid, because we're going to use the plasmid, right? To carry the human gene into the bacterial cell. You got that? Now the instructions in the lab tell you to cut those things out, but I just wanted to talk to you about those. Alrighty.